AI, but Willy, the colleague I was with, for personal reasons, couldn't make it to Zagreb. We wish her well. I brought another colleague from the Netherlands, Jan Klopper. And Jan and I are the designers of OpenCAD, and what we want to show you is how we deal with data. I had my talk yesterday on OpenCAD. I'm not going to repeat that, obviously, but there's one thing very important is if you deal with security, security, it's all about context and having the right information. And there's a lot out there, and we built a whole system where we can collect through APIs information, store it in our graph, and then see more than what other tools do. So basically what this is basically one big shout out for help. So Jan has hopefully the environment up and running.
Unfortunately, I do not.
You do not?
I do not, no. So this is always the problem with running on live repositories. It's coming online, but I can't log in for some reason.
Yeah.
Yeah, can you just repeat what he said?
I will, however,
sure.
Get through all the different plugins and where you can find the code.
Hoeveel tijd heb je nodig?
I can try rerunning it and then maybe it just comes online.
Okay, sorry. I will start to repeat it. Jan has an issue, so he's restarting his system. So he will need a couple of minutes. I will repeat what Jan says because it's very hard to understand him. We don't have a connection that we can hook up, I guess. Nope. So basically what we have is a system that all functions around a graph. And graph is basically an object store where you store objects like a domain name, an IP address, port, whatever. And because we store that, what we can do is query that. And you for the ones who weren't there yesterday, think about your own organization, ask yourself the question, do they have a configuration management database that is correctly filled? I could ask here again, but I know for sure nobody will raise their hand that they have because no organization has that. So what we try to do is grab information and then basically try to query this in as many ways as we can think of. So have one correct administration. So that is what we do. And we add to what we see all things that we know from public sources. For instance, you've got the common vulnerability exposure of flaws in software. You've got software bill of materials. If you combine the two and you detect a piece of software, you can then say like, okay, I see, for instance, WordPress. I know it has 1,500 packages there that need to be there, else it won't function. So if there is a CVE in any of these packages, I want to know. So that is what we've built, and that is what we store in the database, and we get that through APIs. We call Boofius, we call everything after cats. And these APIs, basically what they do is they get in all the raw data that we can get. And then we'll store it, we'll sign it, we'll make sure that it is forensically sound. And then through normalizers, we call whiskers, we will interpret the data that we do understand. Yeah, there might be things that you don't understand. For instance, you download HTML, you think, you have a piece of code you don't understand, so you leave it out. And then later on, you learn through an open source, for instance, wait, this piece of code means a crypto miner, evil software. Now what we then can do is go back to the data store and say, okay, and where did we download this? And each occurrence is a marker in time that we can say, oh wait, this is when I did see it, this is when I didn't see it. So apparently in this time frame, it started to happen. So when I now do a forensic investigation, I really know exactly, or not exactly, but you really know between the two times, this is where I should start to look. So then we throw it in the object model and then we can query it. We don't have an opinion about it, it's just a collection of facts, and those facts are basically fed to what we call bits. And a bit is basically a business rule that says, like, if A, then B must be there as well. So, for instance, if you see a car moving, you know there must be some kind of engine, else it can't move. If A, then B. But if it has an engine, it also has wheels. So, else you still can't move. So if A, then B, then C. And that is basically what we do. Meanwhile, I'm looking at Jan. Yeah. Can you share your screen?
I will share my screen and take you through the onboarding.
Yeah. This is always the danger of doing a live demo.
Yep. Let's take that window, share it. So you should be able to see my screen now.
Yeah. I'll explain, Jan, because I also have to repeat you, so just click away. Basically, we've done whole onboarding. Basically, we set up a report. We try to collect data. And while we are doing that, by adding a URL, and we've got, it's too bad you don't understand Dutch, but we've got a domain called mispo.es, a Spanish domain, because the Dutch way of saying that you failed is, one of the ways of saying it is mispoes, which is a failed cat. So, yeah. So you start, we start the collections of APIs and then set a clearance level. What are we allowed to do? We've got four levels of clearance because as a ministry you cannot start hacking the rest of the world. It's kind of illegal. So you need to have permission for that, and we built a whole system that we safeguard that the permission is there. Yeah, and then basically it starts to collect data. And is there, in the meantime, Jan, a way to show the graph, given the lack of time that we have? No, then no,
I can show some code on GitHub.
Yeah. Okay. So we start to the better goods, the code.
Let's see. It's scanning in the background, obviously.
Yeah, and for your understanding, why is it so slow? Because Jan is using his laptop and he's running the full system on his laptop.
Certificate transparency.
Yeah, we've made one move here that is a certificate transparency. So we have got this open data source that all certificates that are being made will pass. Now, if you are looking for instance, subdomain names, there is the best way to find out is to go to certificate transparency, because then we know for sure it's being used. So. Can you make kun je de letters iets groter maken? Ja, yeah, now we can. It's basically really this simple on how to write it. Just get the JSON in and put it in the object model. And then as soon as it's in the object model and we found a certificate, we know that there is a certificate, but we also know that there is a subdomain name or a domain name. And because of that, we can start to scan that subdomain, of course, if we have the permission to do so. And it's basically, just one, basically one or two lines of code to add the domain name. It's really that simple. So you can write bouffes like this in, I think this was made in like 1 or 2 hours.
Yeah.
And then that will end up in the object model, and it's there for multiple purposes. Yeah, the business rules, they are even more fun. Because the one thing is having facts in the database, but the next thing is the logic reasoning, and that is what we do with bits. So what we say, like, if A, then B, if something happens as a fact in the database, we need to do something with it. So... this is, for instance, checking a header, and this is a funny one to explain, because you take in a web page, you also have the headers. If you have a header, you can, for instance, whitelist a domain name. Now, there are a lot of tools that check that you have headers. Only few check if you have whitelisted domains. No tool, as far as I'm aware, will put that domain in the graph and then start to look, okay, if I see this domain name, what do I know about it? And then, for instance, discover that the domain name had a typo and doesn't exist, which means that any evil person can register that domain name and put malware on there, and you've whitelisted this for your website. So that's really, sometimes it's 3-4 lines of code. Headers, of course, it can be a whole bunch of things. That is, that's a lot more. Yeah, if you can scroll down. Here you see if the domain name delivers an NX domain, which is the internet's way of saying like it doesn't exist, then we make a new fact that we have a domain in our graph that doesn't exist, and that will get a high finding, actually a 10.0 out of, from 0 to 10, it gets a 10. So basically, this is all you need to do to get all the contextual data that you need. Well, the fun of it is then, this is a view at the graph, and you see that we've collected a whole bunch of information. Deliberately, we misconfigured this domain. That may be obvious. And you see a couple of findings already.
Lots of information.
Yeah.
I'll add some more bouffes.
Yeah, now if you add bouffes, so new plugins. Certificate sounds good. Green hosting. Well, green hosting is maybe not very important for you, but if we've got a Dutch political party called Green Left, if they ended up hosting at Shell, for instance, you know, that's something you might want to know. There are some certificates, for instance. The basic point is, as soon as you click it on, we've got a scheduler, and you start adding more and more information. And this is why I came out here today, because we want to get help, because the more bouffes, the more fun we have. And you have probably over here specific... Specific data sets that we don't know about, because it's like Croatian. We would love to add that as well. We are also looking at, of course, Dutch-specific things. But that would make the context information more valuable. Let's see where you're now with the findings, for instance.
I will go to findings.
And now all of a sudden you find a whole bunch of things that are missing, like you don't have DNSSEC, which is in the Netherlands, according to the Dutch government rule, something you should have. So that's not okay. One of the funny things is you don't have an IP version 6 address, which is low, which is not a big deal. But because of that, you're in compliance with certain standards. So it will take a little bit of time, and then it starts to reason like, wait, if you don't have this, and you do have, and you don't adhere to this standard, then you don't have secure email for Dutch healthcare, for instance. And maybe you can show the findings again, because we're now at 107 objects, but it will keep filling meanwhile all the time. And then I think it's time to open up the floor for some questions and make it a bit more interactive. Oh, you've got a high now, because apparently you've got the database port open, 3306. Maybe actually using MySQL should be a finding, but let's not go that route. But we think that is uncool, so we give that a high value. The database keeps growing over time. I think it's a nice moment to start opening up the floor for questions. And of course, if people want to know more, we can go in depth with you on a one-on-one.
Benno, the process of creating boosters, as you've shown in your GitHub, is pretty open. You have a curation process in place, a verifying input. Can you tell maybe the audience a bit on how they can connect with you and Jan to start making more boosters and contributions?
Absolutely. There are a lot of questions in this one question. The first one is, do we have curation? Yes. Basically, what we have a team of 12 people who are working on OpenCut, and we curate the environment. And what we build is basically the operating system of the security tool, and we are less working on the APIs ourselves. So if something comes in, we've got a regular process. You shoot in a PR, we check it, and then release it to our branches. And we have got testing in place. We have got code reviewers running around and pen testers as well. So we do a lot of effort in getting a high quality. How can you join? Go to opencat.nl and send us an email, or shoot me down right here when I'm around here for the rest of the day. Or send me an email, brenno@dewinter.com. I'll put it on the screen in a second. That's, I think, the best way to get started. And if you think, I don't know jack shit about writing APIs, it's too difficult, you probably speak a different language. And we would love to have other languages besides Dutch, English, Frisian, and Papiamento. Those are the languages spoken in the Netherlands. Any other questions? Outbursts?
Thank you, Brennan.
Thank you. And thank you, Jan.